Good morning. It is great to be back with you after 2 years. My name is JJ Warren. Like Pastor Eleanor said, I'm a sophomore at Sarah Lawrence College in Bronxville, New York. My home church is Penn Yan United Methodist Church, just up the lake here. I think that's the right direction, or that way, Penn Yan folks. And I'm currently in the ordination process in the United Methodist Church. So that's everything you need to know about me in one really long run-on sentence, and now we're acquainted. You can laugh. Great. Awesome. There we go. Actually, to tell you a little bit more about myself, I flew back yesterday from Florida to be with you here today. That's how much I like this church, so you're pretty great. Awesome. So I flew back yesterday, but while I was in Florida, I got to spend a lot of time with my 19-month-old nephew. His name is Hunter. Nothing says spring break like a baby, right? I got to hang out with my 19-month-old nephew, and he was just the cutest little guy, and he loves the ocean, which is great, because I love the ocean. Except when I go to the ocean, I love to go to relax, you know, to sit on the beach. He hasn't quite gotten that part yet, but he likes to run in the water. I would throw seashells, and he would go chase them, and he would do that afterwards. He would love to run around, and after a while, he would get tired. You know, it was time to go. So every day after the beach, we'd pack up and we'd go into the car. And I learned after a while that eventually Hunter will fall asleep because he's tired. It's what he needs. The question was, how will he fall asleep? Will the car ride home be peaceful and relaxing? Or will it kind of sound like that? Will Hunter kick and scream and do anything he can think of to avoid going to sleep? When we put him in the car, he kicks and he screams, and sometimes he even pushes away his mother, who can nurse him to sleep. He pushes away his mother, who can give him what he needs. So I wonder if he can feel his body needing sleep. Maybe he knows he needs to sleep, but it's not what he wants. To get what he thinks is best, Hunter screams, kicks, throws things, pushes away his mother, the one who cares for him. To get what he wants, Hunter does whatever he feels like, even if that means pushing away the one who loves him most. And seeing this, the way that my nephew lashes out to get what he wants, even if he may feel he needs something else, reminds me of Judas Iscariot. Now, I don't mean to compare my beautiful nephew to the betrayer of Jesus. Hopefully in 10 years he doesn't watch this. But what I think is illuminating for us is to see the similarities between a baby who resists what is best, even going so far as to push away the one who loves him most, his caregiver, and Judas Iscariot, a man who intimately knew Jesus but resisted the ways of God. When Pastor Eleanor invited me to preach today's service, she said I could pick anyone from the Lent story to share with you. And like most people, I wanted to be young, unique, and challenging, so I chose everyone's least favorite character, Judas. Now, usually, though, Judas isn't mentioned in church, unless we're talking about, you know, that guy that betrayed Jesus, the one who pushed away the ultimate caregiver. As much as we blame Judas, though, I don't think I've heard us ask, why Judas betrayed Jesus? Why did he do it? And why do we continue to tell this part of the story? What story are we telling? As my nephew pushes away his caregiver, I observe that he does it because he wants to stay awake. Judas maybe felt Jesus' calling, knew that if he had stayed with Jesus, something would have been made right. But he decided to go away from Jesus because he wanted to what? What did Judas want? After observing my nephew, I understood that he acted out because he was fighting for something he wanted and against something that maybe he didn't know he needed. Hopefully, after we observe Judas throughout the Bible, we can understand what he was fighting for and why he fought against God at the end. Maybe Judas has been overlooked all of these years. Maybe Judas has been overlooked because we have preconceptions about his value. Judas the traitor, that's what the church has taught us. That's what I've been told. That's how society has told us to judge Judas. So we overlook him. But maybe, if we understand Judas as a real person, like each of us, maybe Judas isn't so different from us. Maybe we're not so different from Judas or from a baby, both of whom fight, sometimes unknowingly, against what they need in order to get what they want. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, the struggle between wants and needs is something that I always face, and it's not easy. I would like to say that following Jesus is easy, that I wholeheartedly believe the scriptures when they tell me that even in the darkest valley, facing no matter what life throws at me, that I can trust in God 100%, but I can't. I wish I could stand up here and say that I 100% believe Psalm 18 when it says that God's ways are perfect, even when life seems difficult, but I can't. I don't rely on God as much as I should. I seek my own ways sometimes because I think they might be best, even when I feel something else calling me. I don't know about you, but being a Christian is hard. And I think that I actually identify with Judas a little more than I'd like to admit. So if I identify with Judas, and maybe you do too, was Judas all bad? What was Judas able to do with Jesus? What made him turn away? Why do we turn away? And how can we acknowledge the Judas tendencies in our lives, those inner desires that drive us away from God? How can we identify our Judas tendencies without shame, but with honesty and humility? What can Judas teach us today? So let's take a look at Judas's time with Jesus. So we're going to look in Mark. Mark is the earliest written gospel in the New Testament. And so let's look at Mark chapter 3. Jesus gave all of the disciples, including Judas, authority to cast out all demons and to heal all illnesses. And when naming the 12 disciples who received the authority, the author of Mark in verse 19 says, "And Judas Iscariot, who later betrayed him." The author here is foreshadowing. They are telling us what will happen later in the narrative. Judas, who later betrayed Jesus. But why does the author foreshadow? When reading the Bible, it is pertinent for our spiritual growth to read not just for the sake of reading or to fill a daily Bible study, but to unearth the truths that these ancient writers have hidden for us through things like foreshadowing. In the sacred storybook, we read to interpret, to try and understand the meaning of what we are reading. Why the authors felt inspired to write what they did so that thousands of years later we can sit here today reading these same words. We aren't here reading this book to just read these words, but to experience them, to be changed by them. Perhaps the author employed foreshadow to warn us. To warn us that even though we are called children of God, even though we may do good deeds to be like Jesus, all of us are susceptible to temptation. It doesn't matter who we are, parishioner, pastor, bishop, even president, we are all susceptible to temptation. We are all at risk to be tempted away from the desires of God for our lives, and toward fulfilling our own desires, our own wants. Perhaps this is why the author of Mark in chapter 9 foreshadowed Judas, who later betrayed Jesus. To foreshadow, to warn us that we must stay alert. Even though we may do good things now, we are susceptible to temptation. We are still only human, and we are weak. The author of Mark is acknowledging that anyone can be tempted, even those in positions of authority or those who do good works for God. So let's keep looking at Judas's life. So we know that later in this gospel, that Judas and the disciples heal masses, and they perform exorcisms, they cast out demons, while they're going to Jerusalem with Jesus. And it's years later when Judas's name is specifically stated again, and it's at that moment that we've all heard about, right? Judas the betrayer. And so let's read Mark 14, verse 10, and then we'll skip to verse 17. So verses 10 and 11. Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. That's why there's coins at the cross today. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. Now verse 17. While the disciples were sitting with Jesus to celebrate the feast of Passover, it was evening, and he came with the 12. When they had taken their places and they were eating with Jesus, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to become distressed and say to one another, "Surely it can't be me, I can't be that guy." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me." Judas is celebrating the Passover meal with Jesus. He is performing the ritual of faith. But it doesn't seem to have meaning for him. How many times have we come to the communion table, taken the bread and dipped it, and left, returning to our seats thinking nothing more than, that bread wasn't as moist as last week. You know, honestly, how many times have we come to a Christmas service out of ritual and habit, and we haven't left feeling the real hope that Jesus coming into the world brings? And as Lent comes to a close with Easter soon, how many of us would approach another Easter Sunday, see a picture or a display of an empty tomb and think, seen that before, a neat trick? Because we've heard the same story for 20, 30, maybe 40 plus years. We've heard the same stories, but do we ask why they matter to us? How many of us come to the table of God like Judas out of ritual and not out of a practice of heartfelt, convicted belief? How many of us, we see the author tells us in Mark 9 that Judas was doing the work of God. Many of us do the work of God. We know Judas was involved in miracles, and yet here we see the same man, years later, sitting down with the Son of God, not out of admiration or worship, but out of ritual and routine. The story of Judas, friends, is our story. It's a warning to us from the ancient writers, a foreshadow of what can happen to us, kind of like the ghost of Christmas future in A Christmas Carol. We know, we saw in the past what Judas was able to do when he believed in Jesus's power. And we have seen what happened to Judas after he was jaded by years of living in economic poverty while doing ministry. It wasn't what he wanted. This is the ghost of Christmas future. This is the ghost of Judas future. This is what the author is warning us can happen to us if we become numb to the touch and the name of Jesus, if we allow the stories of Jesus's power to become routine rituals that we hear every year, if we become Christians who practice rituals and not heartfelt, convicted beliefs. Judas became jaded because he was what the society called a zealot. Judas, as all Jews were oppressed by the Roman Empire, which raided their temples because they worshipped a faceless god. The society ridiculed them for not joining in the pagan festivals. They were different to the majority society. And so Judas knew the ancient prophecies of the former prophets. And Judas heard these, and he heard the prophecies about a great king who would deliver the Jews, who would come again and to lower the mountains and to raise up the valleys. Judas heard this, and Judas wanted a king. Judas wanted a king to ride into Jerusalem on a chariot with an army and to overthrow Rome. That's what Judas wanted. Jesus was and is the fulfillment of these prophecies, but not how Judas expected or wanted. Jesus fulfills what we need in our lives, sometimes not how we expect or want. Judas wanted a king to ride into Jerusalem, but Jesus did the exact opposite, riding on a donkey, sending a message to the community then and to us today that the kingdom of God is here, and that the kingdom of God is not violent or conquering, but is loving and serves with humility. Judas wanted Jesus to crush the mountains, to destroy the empire. But Jesus raised the poor by serving the poor. The Son of God spent his time with the poor. These were the ways of God, God's plan that was unseen to Judas, God's ways of meeting our spiritual needs, and yet Judas wanted something different. So Judas decided to turn away and to seek to accomplish his own goal by his own power. Judas was the screaming baby, kicking and pushing away the caregiver who was trying to give the baby what it needs. Judas needed that freedom from oppression. And if he had stayed convicted with Jesus, he would have gotten that. Because that's what Jesus offered then, and that's what Jesus offers us today. Judas kicked and screamed to get what he wanted, and in doing so, he resisted what his soul needed. We must identify our temper tantrums, recognize when we are seeking to fulfill our own desires for economic stability, for the right retirement package, for promotion, for a perfect image, the right way to do ministry. We must identify these thoughts and actions, and we must align ourselves through everything that we say and do with the purposes of God for our lives. We have seen the ghost of Judas past, the excited follower of God. We have seen the ghost of Judas future, the jaded Judas who no longer discerns what God's ways might be and instead seeks to accomplish his own goals. Will the ghost of Judas future be your future? What does the present you, Christian, look like? To counter the world's influences and temptations, we must be diligent. Being a Christian isn't easy. We must work hard at our relationship with God. We must submit our desires to the desires of God for our lives. We must realign our resources, our money, our time, even our wants with God's wants for our lives. And I know we're Methodists, so I'll wrap this up quick because we like short sermons. So that all sounds really great, right? Like if we realign our lives, we'll be living like God wants us to. But how do we do that? So really quick, if we look through scripture, the scripture tells us that essentially God has three purposes for our lives, and they're all interconnected. The first one, John 17:3, says that we would know God and Jesus whom God sent. And then Isaiah 43:7 says, everyone who is called by my name, I have created for my glory. So from these scriptures, we can pull that our purpose in life, our number one purpose, is to know God and to praise God. That is our number one purpose, to know and to praise God in everything that we do. Number two, Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus and said, therefore be imitators of God as beloved children. As Christ loved us, walk in love. So we can see from this verse that we were created by God to be like God, like Jesus, which means to love and embrace all people. And our third and final purpose here, and this is just an abstract way, so I'm sure there's many more that play into this, but number three, finally Jesus directly tells us, because he knew we'd stand here questioning, Jesus directly tells us in Matthew 28, go therefore and make disciples of all people, of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age. From this verse, we can see that our purpose is to make God known, to share God with everyone we encounter, whether that be at the grocery store or by giving today to UNCOR to support our neighbors across the globe. So our three purposes that God gave us, to know and to praise God, to be like God, like Jesus, and to make God known, sharing God with everyone that we meet. I have my lock screen on my phone says these three things. It says, God's purposes for my life, to know God and to praise God, to be like God and to make God known, because I don't know about you, but I need reminders. Because every time I turn on my phone, I'm gonna text someone or I'm gonna post something, and I need to remember that every decision I make needs to be realigned with God's purposes for my life. To avoid the ghost of Judas' future, we must identify our weaknesses without shame. That's why the cross is here, because Jesus took our shame so that we could identify those, so that we could then keep God's purposes in mind as we make every decision with our money, with our time, with our dreams of life, so that everything we do and dream about would be aligned with God's purposes for our lives. When we stop kicking and screaming, we allow the caregiver to provide for us. We are given what we need, and we have an intimate relationship with God. To understand Judas today was an attempt to understand ourselves. The author was and is warning us that we are all susceptible to temptation because we are human. And we are all susceptible to come to the table of God, to approach God's presence out of ritual and not heart-convicted belief. But if we continue to draw close to God, aligning our lives with God's purposes for us, we will be provided for. That's a promise. And we will be true, believing, convicted followers of Jesus. So let us go forth today as people who are convicted that in Jesus is life, and that by praising God, living like God, and sharing God with all people, we can and we will bring the kingdom of God to earth here, starting in Bath, New York. We can be transformed from our selfish ways. We can be realigned with God's ways. And when we do so, we can transform this world into a place of peace and love, into the new Jerusalem. The new Jerusalem comes down to earth. The world doesn't go up to heaven. The image of heaven comes here, and we are tasked with bringing that image. And it starts today, and it starts with us. Amen. Thank you.